As you've seen, the analysis techniques that we've been developing, the ones where we can actually solve for problems, they rely on assumptions, and typically they rely on kinematic and stress assumptions, which then produce simplified equations that we can then readily solve. And I'd like to discuss this in a little bit more detail, and this is going to lead to something known as St. Finans Principle. So first of all, the assumptions that we make can only really be assessed by looking at a full set of solutions to the complete equations, okay? And that can be quite difficult to do, or engaging in very extensive experimental work. So this is rather difficult, but there are some things that we can understand even without that. And this is something known, will lead to something known as St. Finans Principle, and it's the primary limitation of the type of assumptions that we make. So let me consider a bar that I'm pushing on with a very localized force P at the top. And if I assume that the material is homogeneous, the assumptions that we've been making are that if I make a section cut anywhere along the length of the bar, that I'm going to end up with a uniform state of stress here. So this is my assumption. So all the kinematic assumptions and stress assumptions we've been making lead to a uniform state of stress no matter where I make this section cut with respect to x. So I can make it very close to the top, very close to the bottom. It's not going to really matter. Now, the reality of the situation is a fair bit different. If I make the section cut up near the top, what I'm going to find is that there's going to be a non-uniform distribution of stress. It's going to be concentrated more towards the center so that it lines up better with this concentrated load that I've applied at the top of the bar here. Now, the amazing thing is that if I make the section cut further down the bar, I'll actually observe that the stress state is essentially uniform in the system. And this leads to the concept of what's known as St. Finans Principle. St. Finans Principle says that the manner in which the load is applied only matters near the point of application. So in this particular example, I've applied the load with a concentrated load at the top, but it really only matters near the top of the bar where the load is applied. And near is actually defined, or normally ends up being defined with respect to the cross-sectional dimension here. So if this cross-sectional dimension is d, typically, if you get one characteristic distance away, so this would be d, you'd find that at this location here, the stresses would be quite nearly uniform. In fact, you can do the case for looking at exactly one characteristic distance away with for a point force on a bar, and you find that this is stress here will be uniform to within 2.5%. So it's actually a pretty good assumption. But when you're very close to the end, it's actually going to change. And so the manner in which loads are applied are things where you're going to be applying the load actually, or even supports which also apply loads. Then they apply loads in very complex ways, but as long as we keep one characteristic distance away, say from supports or from points where the loads are applied, the theories that we've been developing give us very good results for the state of stress and strain in them. There's some other special cases that one should worry about, and one that's important to remember about is rapid changes in cross-sectional dimensions. So if I have a bar with a hole drilled through the middle of it, I have to worry about the state of stress. So if I make a section cut, say, between the hole and the end of the bar, the stress would be P over A, so uniformly. But if I make a section cut through the hole, one would be tempted to say that the stress is equal to P divided by the net area at this section, and it would be uniform. But the reality of it is that there's actually a stress concentration. So the stresses themselves, they kind of rise as you come near to the edge of the hole, and then you have this peak value here, and you have that on both sides over there. And the stress here, the peak stress, is usually given in terms of the nominal stress, so P over the net area times some factor here, which is known as the stress concentration factor. And it's relatively complicated matter to calculate the stress concentration factor. You have to solve the full equations of elasticity, so all those partial differential equations. But for a lot of common cases, you can look these up in tables and graphs. So you can also still do very practical analysis without having to solve the full partial differential equations. Just as an example of what stress concentration factors look like, suppose I have a hole in a plate, maybe it's an elliptical hole with dimensions a by b. The stress concentration factor is roughly 1 plus 2 times the ratio of A over B. So as the hole becomes more and more slender, say it looks like a crack, then the stress concentration rises very rapidly towards infinity. So that this is one special case you have to worry about. So rapid changes in cross sections, and it's not just interior changes in cross sections; it's also exterior. So if you have a step down dimension in a bar, say going from one diameter to another, you also have to worry about a stress concentration in this region here, where the cross sectional dimensions are changing rapidly.